It is the 12th of March.
We never know the dates.
Yeah, I wrote it down, but I'm still not convinced. Is that the right?
It is. It's the 12th of March. Yeah.
How do we not know this basic stuff?
So funny.
So it's Sunday, the 12th of March. Yeah. This is the Olann and Magazine podcast. I am Laura.
And this is Deirdre. And you can find us at olannand.ie, and by now we've published a new issue.
Yeah.
I think it was like 10 days ago, I guess, yeah. Not yet 2 weeks. It feels like about a month ago, but I think it was about 10 days ago. It was a Wednesday the 1st. Yeah, well, that makes sense.
Yeah.
We hope you've been checking it out. We're really proud of it. It looks really well. A lot of hard work went into it, so we're delighted that it looks so nice. And there's been a good reaction, actually.
Yeah, everybody's been saying that they really like the new look.
Yeah.
A few last minute panic things, weren't there?
Yeah, goodness.
God, things aren't working, and different plugins and stuff weren't working.
Plugins, they're like a dirty word.
We're totally like, it should work. Why doesn't it do what it says it does?
Yeah.
It doesn't work, so. It does look really good.
Yeah, I'm really happy with it. And it's packed full of content. So if you haven't gone there already, then I would go there right now after you watch this at www.olannand.ie.
We're on Facebook as Olann and Magazine. No, Olann and. And then on Instagram as Olann and Magazine, and Twitter is
just Olann and.
Yeah. We're not going to talk about the P word.
That's another dirty word. And then individually, we're I'm Deirdre McCardle on Instagram and Donna Diamond on Ravelry.
And I am Left Foot Daisy everywhere. Left Foot Daisy on Ravelry, Instagram, Facebook. And I have a blog, which is fibrestrumpet.com. I think that's all the housekeeping.
Yeah, I think it is.
Yeah. Oh, and just to say, obviously, for those of you that have missed it, our next issue, we changed our publishing schedule to quarterly. Our next issue will be May.
End of May.
So, and there's no rest for the wicked. We took maybe 2 days where we were all and hand free, possibly, maybe. But we're already back on to the next issue now. The idea was with going from bi-monthly to quarterly that we'd have a bit more time in case there was any hiccups.
I guess it allows us to, because you know, we were test knitting everything as well, and that was every 2 months was putting us under. It was a lot of pressure, I guess.
Yeah.
Just especially if it was something a bit complex or larger. So it gives us a bit more time.
A bit more time to do things as well around it, doesn't it?
And
try and make sure that we have time to write blog posts and do podcasts and stuff like that, because otherwise you're just like, oh no.
it's a constant loop, and we couldn't catch our breath.
No, definitely not.
This is good. Yeah.
Okay. So will we kick off with, we were going to talk to you predominantly today about the Marshmallow Hot Chocolate shawl, because it's also going to be our first knit along of 2017.
So
we'll talk to you about that a bit. Will I show one of them?
Sure. So it's the original one.
So this is the original. So I don't know if you can see, we've both disappeared. So as you can see, it's a heavyweight, it's actually an Aran weight lace, all over lace design shawl. The actual pattern is called the Marshmallow Hot Chocolate.
Oh, yeah.
We keep getting it wrong. I keep getting it wrong, should I say, because I kept writing it out as hot chocolate marshmallow.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just stuck in my head and I can't stop.
I hate when that happens.
So this one has actually got a picot bind off. And as you can see, this is the two colour version. The yarn, this was designed by Ruth
McKeon,
Who designs under the name Knitalong. She's an Irish designer.
Mm-hmm.
It's an Aran weight shawl. When we were talking to Ruth originally about what we were after, we knew that the issue that we just published was going to be our warm and cozy issue, so nothing in the magazine was going to be under an Aran weight. And we said what we were after, and she's like, great, I've got a design that I think I can use for that.
Mm-hmm.
So this one is done in Drops Alaska. What are the
colours? So off-white, 02, and brown 23.
Yeah.
And it's 100%, 100%. Well, it is. Feels lovely and scrummy and woolly and cosy. Well, exactly what we wanted, really, isn't it? And it's like a really nice, these little lace repeats are the marshmallows.
Yeah.
And it's kind of cute when you think about it that way. They're like little puffs.
And it's a 10-row lace repeat. It's a lovely, easy, easy lace pattern, very intuitive. Ruth's pattern is extremely well written. There was no need to check anything, if you know what I mean. It was all 100% right. That's the ball band for the Alaska, in case you haven't seen it. This is actually the one that I knitted the brown version in, but so this is the mix. Whereas I think these are uni. U-N-I? Uni?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Okay.
So I think they do an Alaska uni and then an Alaska mix. Okay. So that's the one with the pico edge. So you actually have I suppose a few different ways that you could be doing this. So you can do it with the pico edge, you can do it with the plain edge, you can do it in a two color version, or you can do it in a solid. So this is the solid version that we did, and this one doesn't have the pico edge. I'll put this up behind it so you can see.
That's really nice, isn't it? Yeah.
And because this one didn't have the picots, if you look at the border, I didn't pull out the border. I kind of let, when I blocked it, I let it fall as it would do naturally, and just kind of almost shaped those. So it's a less defined ripple, I suppose, than the other one. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's really nice. Yeah.
And it's very, very warm. Very, very warm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in the magazine, we made sure that we gave you different ideas of how to wear the shawl. Yeah. Because it's so versatile, like you can like totally encase yourself in it, but also then it's just nice to drape over your shoulders. So it's really, really versatile.
Yeah.
And it's just perfect, like, for throwing on if you're going out in the evening, or, you know.
Yeah.
It's just so cozy.
It's a really nice design. I love the way, actually, in the brown, it looks slightly different to
it does,
the... When you first look at it, the lace doesn't look the same. And I even questioned myself. Okay. I was like, I've done it wrong. But then when you open it up, you can see that they are the same. I think it's just the change in the colour.
Yeah. No, it's really pretty.
So they're the two, two stroke four, depending on colours and stuff, official versions of the cow. And then we had one of our good friends, Dr. Sock. She also test knitted it for us because we wanted to have a good variety of colours, because we knew it was our knit along that we put in the magazine to show you. And Dr. Sock, she used another drop yarn. She used the Nepal, which is these. Yeah. And what's this one? So this one is orange 2920. And this one is dark purple 4439.
Uh-huh.
And the composition is different, which you can tell from the feel of it,
right,
can't you?
Yeah.
So the composition for that is 65% wool and 35% alpaca.
It's not coming out too bad, is it? No, actually the orangeness is nice and orangey.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's not Satsuma-like.
No, it's not. It's not blowing out and being like a real kind of, or even a red. It's nice and orangey. It's kind of more representative of what it is. Yeah, actually, yeah.
Probably it's good. Maybe a slightly bit more burnt than that, possibly.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, because this is a mix, isn't it? This one's a mix.
Oh yeah, the alpaca and the wool.
Yeah. So the purple is a solid purple, and then the orange is like a marl, I suppose, slightly.
Okay.
So it has some different colours going through it, doesn't it? A little bit more different.
Yeah, actually, and you can see that on the border, that we've done the two colour border, and without, well, obviously no pico edge, but it's different to yours as well.
The increases are only at the end, so
It's straighter.
Dr. Sock only did the increases at the end. She didn't want the ruffle.
Mm-hmm.
So she did the increase at the end, which we've put all the details of that on the knit along page in the magazine, of how Dr. Sock changed it. I think because it's got the alpaca in it, it drapes slightly differently to the other one, doesn't it?
No, it's really pretty.
It's very, very nice. Yeah, very, very nice. So you have, so between those, between the three there, effectively you have six different options, because you could still do a picot bind off on the edges here.
That's
if
true.
You wanted to.
Yeah, yeah.
Six or maybe seven.
Or you could, and you could, you didn't, you wouldn't need to do a two colour here, you could just do a plain.
Solid, yeah. And I think, if I remember rightly, because it was drop yarn, it definitely cost under €25. I think we bought the yarn when there was a sale on anyway.
Mm.
But I think it would still cost you under €25, possibly under 20 if you use the drop yarn.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's really good, isn't it?
Yeah.
For a shawl of that size.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
And we thought it would be a really good one to do for a knit along, because I know we're coming into the warmer months and we have a glorious day here today. But you can guarantee it's St. Patrick's Day next Friday.
Mm.
It's usually raining.
Yeah.
I think there's been snow on a couple of occasions when I've done St. Patrick's
it
Day.
Is,
here.
For sure. Yeah,
so
yeah.
It usually turns again. And you know, even if you weren't, if it wasn't maybe something that you wore now, you could save it for the cooler months as they come back in after the summer. That sounds awful to talk about that. Or you could do it for a gift.
Yeah, that's true actually. Yeah.
I'm thinking I probably will make it again, but I think I with the knit along, if you like,
yes,
going along with the knit along.
Yeah.
But I'll probably make it for as a gift, I think.
Okay.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
So I've been looking at yarn and then thinking I really should use my
because I was looking through my stash of Aran and I don't have a whole lot of Aran.
Don't
actually.
You? No. See, I am thinking of making it in a slightly different weight, which is another option you could do. You could make it in a lighter weight if you wanted to.
Oh, right.
The needle size that Ruth specified was a 5mm. I ended up using a 5.5 on mine.
Okay.
And I'm pretty sure Dr. Sock used a 5.5 on hers. Sorry. She's always Dr. Sock. She's never anybody else.
I know, yeah.
I'm terrible. I call everybody has a nickname. So I think, and I was toying with making it with a cotton.
Oh, okay.
Don't particularly like knitting with cotton.
Yeah.
But I just thought maybe taking that and using an Aran weight cotton for summer might be nice. I think the design would lend itself quite well to cotton. So to qualify for our knit along.
Oh yeah. So to qualify for a knit along, you have to be a member of the Olann and group on Ravelry. So again, if you haven't already signed up or gone in there, do so. I mean, look, we have the knit alongs, but we also have bits and pieces going on during the time as well. And then there's a thread there for the Cal. And then if you just pop in there and post count me in, then we'll know, you know, that you're going to be doing it. And then that means then that you qualify for all the prizes. And then as well, when you're setting up your project page on Ravelry, just remember that one of the tags needs to be Olann and Marshmallow Cal, just so we can kind of keep track of it. We're going to have a few prizes, obviously, for those of you who do participate in the Cal. And so as usual, we have some nice little bits. One of the first one is going to be a €25 voucher for the Constant Knitter in Dublin, and that's Rosemary, and she has a really good selection of, well, nice selection of indie dyers, actually Irish local indie dyers, which is great.
Yeah.
But she has loads of other goodies, like, you know, so it'd be a nice. And she has online. Does she have online?
She does.
Shopping?
I was talking to her recently. She's updating the online shop.
Okay. Yeah.
So that will be interesting to see.
Yeah, good.
She's just got the Rib magazine in.
Oh, has she?
Yeah, recently she got the Rib magazine in. sorry. I was going to say she just got Rib in. Thank God I said magazine.
Yes. Yeah.
And you were making me laugh when you said about the tag, because when I was trying to work out a tag for the Cal, I was going to call it Olann and Hot Cal. I probably shouldn't call it that.
No.
Hot Cal. Yeah, and then Ruth said, said that she would donate a couple of patterns. Once I talk to Ruth, I'll talk to Ruth this week and I'll list the prizes on the Ravelry thread, and I'll go in and I'll add them to the knit along feature on the magazine as well.
Oh yeah, so, yeah, cool.
And yeah, and if you join the thread, we'd love to encourage you to post pictures of the yarn that you want to use.
Oh yeah, that'd be interesting.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking, actually, I'm going to say this on camera now, so if it's not bad. I was thinking, I noticed that we're up near. Oops. Oh dear.
We hate technology.
Oh. So yeah, so I was thinking that I noticed because we've got nearly 200 people, was thinking, excuse me, like there's people that don't like to chat on the board, I thought it might be nice to have a, which is understandable, don't get me wrong, but I'm more for grabbing people and saying, tell us something about yourself. So I was thinking maybe if we did a pass it on, so like I go on and say a bit about me and then I pass it on to maybe, I don't know, number 4 or something on the thing, or to you, and then pass it on. Do you see what I mean? And then so that everybody that's joined the group, we have a thread where we all.
Oh, cool! Yeah, that'd be nice. Yeah,
I don't know.
I mean, we have the.
So run now if you're on the right.
Yeah. I have to talk. I can't just lurk around in the shadows. I do that in loads of groups.
Oh my god! I've been reading this. I'm on this group. I've said it. It's all right. I'm on this group and. There just seems to be an awful lot of kind of biting out of people.
Oh,
and
really?
I really find the group informative, but it's one of those groups that I just don't want to comment on.
Okay.
Because I think it will be picked up the wrong way. And it's very difficult to not read these other people's comments who are just biting at people, thinking that they're not biting at people. But, maybe if they put emojis on there
Smiley face, but it's okay.
isn't meant to be how you're reading it kind of thing, but
I don't like that.
No, a bit strange. So yeah, so if you want to take part in that, it's going to be running from, it starts next Sunday, is next Sunday. That'll have given everybody that goes out for St. Patrick's Day to recover. And then it's going to run for 8 weeks. And it's going to finish on the 14th of May, Sunday the 14th of May. And about a week after kickoff, we'll open a finished objects cow. Because it really is that quick, to be fair, because it's a narrow weight, sure.
Yeah, okay, yeah, it flies up.
Yeah, if you were knitting it monogamously, you'd get it done in a week easily.
Right, wow.
So I think that's, have we covered everything on that?
I think so. Went through all the different versions, the dates, what you need to do to be in with the chance of winning the prizes. And yeah, it would be good to see progress shots as well. So if you kind of have, if you have any questions, actually Ruth Knitterarium, the designer, said she was going to do it again as well, and she'll be around on the thread. So that'd be great actually to have the designer on board. If you do have any questions about the pattern, she'll be there to answer them.
And if you've never done a shawl before, or you're not feeling very confident about it, I suggested to one of our followers, Joanna. That maybe what you could do is just do the garter stitch tab at the top. I've knit so many shawls lately, I'm just trying to think, I'm sure there's a tab. And then do the first 10 rows of the pattern and just do them in any old yarn, just to get yourself acquainted with it. You'd get through that easily in an hour, and then you'd know if it was for you or if it wasn't.
And as well, it's probably a good starter shawl because of the weight of it. You know, you're not dealing with 4-ply.
It is. And there's only increases at either end, so it's not a triangle shawl. It's a crescent shawl. That's something we didn't say.
Yeah.
It's a crescent shawl. So it's not, it hasn't got increases going down the centre and at the edges.
Okay.
It's a nice shawl project, actually.
Good. Cool.
I think we've done that.
Yeah.
No pressure. Yeah. Okay, so.
Oh, yeah. So in this current issue, we have we kind of amalgamated our Handmade in Ireland and our Kits, Tools and Quirky Bits from the previous issues into one feature called Olann and Loves. And that allows us to, I guess it just allows us to not be strictly Handmade in Ireland, although we do still want to focus on Irish products, and in fairness actually most of them turned out to be Irish, which is good. We do, like, you know, the whole point of us doing the magazine is to highlight Irish crafters and designers and yarn, you know, indie dyers and yarn shops, so that is going to be our focus. But also if we see things that you guys would be interested in from further afield, then we want to highlight those as well. So that's the whole point of it. We found a few little bits, and one of them is, I think we probably always have stitch markers in this section because, look, Yeah. Who doesn't need any more stitch markers? Like, you know, you can never have too many of them. So these ones are really cool. They're from the Magic Sheep Creations. And they're just beautiful little...
There we go. So that's a bit of light. There we go. I actually love the... Is it a bunny or a...
Oh, yeah, it looks like a bunny. But these are really pretty. They're like... I'm just going to hold them up here now for a little while just so you guys can see them. Actually, there's a whole bunch. Pretty little flower stitch markers. And, oh, there we go.
That's it.
Yeah. Bloody hell. And so they're really, really pretty. And like, you know, they look really cute on your knitting. I think anyway. I'd be like, I have these all over the place. Yeah. They're so cute.
They're made from polymer clay. So let's have a look. I wrote down notes because I keep forgetting people's names. So Rachel makes her markers out of polymer clay. It's a set of 12 markers, and in that set there's a pair of 6 different flowers.
Oh yeah.
They're snag free, so they won't damage your precious makes. And the set of 12 is £6.50 plus postage and packaging.
Decent, isn't it?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. And I think it's nice that they're a set of 12.
Actually, yeah. Because that'd be good if you're doing like lace repeats and stuff, you can kind of continue to mark. My voice keeps going, so I'm sorry.
Yeah, do you want some water?
And it's okay, I'll have another sip of tea. If I need an excuse. Sorry.
I think 12, like you said, if it's a lace repeat or maybe even a cable repeat or something that you want to...
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Or like me and you've lost them.
I know. And then, you know, you find stitch markers in the weirdest places, don't you? It's so funny.
I found one this morning. I usually have a piece of weaving on my table as a table runner, but when we do the podcast, I move that. And this morning I ripped it off. This stitch marker just went flying across the kitchen. That's where it is. Okay.
So it's good. Always good to replenish your stock of stitch markers for sure. Yeah.
So we're going to talk about two of the things, aren't we?
Oh yeah.
This episode. So the second thing was the eco natural stuff for dogs and dog lovers.
Mm-hmm. Oops. Here we go. There we go.
Yeah.
That's our card.
So this is Susan Lynch. So Susan Lynch has a passion for natural products and animals brought about the launch of EcoMutt, a range of natural, vegan-friendly grooming products and gifts for dogs and dog lovers. Now, to be fair, I know we're a craft and fibre magazine, but you must know by now that we include other bits and pieces that catch our eyes.
Yeah.
And we're both dog owners.
Yes.
To be fair, like the dogs feature quite a lot in our lives. So Dee has 2 Yorkies called
Scruff and Toby.
Yeah.
You must have heard them barking on podcasts.
And I've got 4 dogs who I took out for a walk before Dee got here, and then they were barking nonstop. So I kicked them out again. I'm like, just get outside, it's fine. So to be fair, I live on a farm, which by now you must know. So my dogs, in the winter we get visited by geese and they eat geese crap, and then in the summer, now the cows have started going out and they just think that's a free for all and let's just eat as much cow crap as we can. Oh, lovely. Mm. Horrible. And then foxes in between that, where they want to roll in it and think it's sexy.
Yeah, yeah.
There's nothing sexy about a dog that smells of fox stuff.
Yikes. I don't envy that, to be honest.
No, that's not nice. It's horrible. You see a dog running across the field and their legs go up in the air and you're like, get up! No. No. So I spotted these and I just thought they were... What actually caught my eye was this one.
Okay, yeah.
Which is a dry dog shampoo. One of my dogs is a Norwegian elk hound and it's a problem to clean her. She has a double coat.
Mm-hmm.
If you wash her, which we really don't do very often, which isn't very good, because she doesn't dry. So if I washed her today, her fur would still be damp in a couple of days.
No way.
Oh yeah, gosh. Which, I mean, she's always running hot, bless her. And she doesn't like the hairdryer. So I was interested in that because, bless her, she does, like, she'd be out there, she'd be scratching away. So it would be nice to think that I could get something that might just clean her up a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't know if it would stay in her. They, as far as like we wormer and I defleer, but they're not prone to fleas anyway because of their thick coat.
Okay.
They can't usually get down. But I'd say living on the farm, the dust must just get into her fur and she's constantly scratching. So I'd be interested to see if
Try
I could
that.
Use that. Yeah.
And then it's all natural. So the flavours, the... What we call them? Scents? Our flavours. Are like citronella, lavender and tea tree. So, you know, it's a pleasant smell as well. It's not like a medicinal smell. These are obviously natural, but some shampoos, dog shampoos, can be a bit like medicinal. We use baby shampoo on our too.
Do you?
Well, their fur is really fine.
Yeah.
Toby's in particular. So, the vet just said just use baby shampoo.
Okay.
But I actually think I will try this shampoo here.
Yeah, there's a shampoo, isn't there? So this one's... Are they all the same? Different? No, that one's different.
This is different than the soap. Is rosemary, lavender and mandarin.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's nice actually.
Yeah, they are really nice actually. So yeah, so you can... So they've got pure essential oil in them. And the dry shampoo you can use... technically use it in between...
Washes. Oh, okay, good.
So yeah, so I'd say what we'll do is we'll give them a go on
our
dogs,
and we'll do a blog.
We'll let you know. Mm. Yeah, we'll do a blog post about them. Yeah, our dogs are gonna love that.
Yeah,
my dogs will hate it.
No, I say the word bath at home, the two guys are like, no, and their ears go down, and then they skunk away into their beds, and then Scruff just goes into a dead weight. So like when they try and lift him up, he's like, no, no. And then if you bring them upstairs and you put them into the bath, if you let them down and kind of turn your back, they're gone.
Yeah.
And you're chasing them around the house. Yeah,
yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
I'm sure most dogs are the same.
Mine, I mean, to be fair, my lab, bless it, was too big to go in the bath.
Like, I'd kill myself.
I'd end up in the bath trying to get her in the bath. She doesn't like getting in the shower, so my husband rigged up a shower outside. And you have to tie her up, so I tie her up and I shower her down. But then as soon as I've finished, toe rag will just go and roll in the mud.
Mm.
And she's taught she's the eldest, so she's taught the other three to do it. So literally, there's no point washing mine. They literally, as soon as they've had their wash, they shake off and then they go and roll in the mud. And I do mean the mud. I don't mean the grass.
Oh God. Oh dear. Well, that's not good.
So
wear you out. You're just like, look, just fine. If you want to be dirty, be dirty.
Yeah, just
grand.
Be gross.
Yeah.
I don't care. So that's two of them. We actually included six items in the Olann and Loves. So we'll do
two again.
Good
idea. Yeah, cool.
So now we have
a few ta-da's. Well, I mean, I went down, well, I suppose I've been... Yeah, I've just too many whips, and so my only ta-da is an embroidery one. You might have seen in the current issue that we did, we had two different embroidery features. One was just looking at the history of embroidery and looking at the state of embroidery in Ireland, which was really interesting, some really nice examples actually, and spoke to a few of the guilds here. And then the other one was an embroidery 101, so it was an interview with a lady I found online about, you know, the basics you need if you were thinking about starting to go down that rabbit hole in particular, and then you know, what you need, the kit, what you can do, the different examples, and then a little video of all the basic stitches actually, which was really really, really well done actually. I was trying to do all the basic stitches and illustrate it, and then I saw this video and I was like, I could never make it look as good as this, so I'm actually just going to put up the video. I know that sounds defeatist, but it was such a good video. I just thought it was really, really cool. So then I thought, okay, I'll get cracking on something for myself, and I made a little...
This is really cool.
It's kind of cute, yeah. It's just little hearts, and then I was going to put like straight things here, but then I just thought I'll mess around and see how I can...
Well, I think that looks better. It looks
make
more...
Make it a little bit wiggly.
Oh, I can't think what the
freehand or like freestyle.
Yeah.
I just did it all, like, I didn't draw anything on this. You probably would tell, to be fair, the heart.
No!
Well, it was weird because I did the red heart first and I just started that on its own. And that, like, is like the perfect heart. And I was like, oh my God, I'm a genius. This is so brilliant. And then as I went along, they got worse and worse. So I actually think that if I was doing it again, I probably would, you know, draw them in and then fill in that, because I think that would force me to stay with it, you know.
I think they're really
nice. I just think that's really cute. But like, look at this one.
No, but they... What is... I always have a problem with trying to get my words. They don't come out the filing cabinet that is my brain. Like they've evolved, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think they look really nice.
I guess, look, none of them are the same, so that's, yeah. I guess it's unique.
No, I think they look really nice. They look like you've sat down and you've done it, do
yeah,
you know what
well,
I mean?
That's
just
true,
like,
yeah.
No, this is what I'm going to do.
That is certainly true.
Yeah.
And so I'm going to give this to my mum. Actually, I'm going to get on my way home here now today. I'm going to go into Tesco because there's one of those pens that Anya, the lady from the patchwork, our new patchwork columnist, is telling us that you can draw on.
Oh, the ones that wash off.
Yeah. So Tesco have those. So I'm going to get that because I want to do writing. And I just thought, actually, I might just do that. I'll do a nice cursive and just have Mum here and give it to Mum for Mother's Day. so then that leads me on to the back, because then I was like, well, I wanted to give it to her in the hoop, you know, because that's kind of modern and a bit quirky.
Yeah.
And you kind of see that nowadays. But I was like, what do I do with the back then? Because I wasn't sure. So I put out a shout on Twitter and asked just that, you know, a beginner embroidery question, what do you do? So a really kind lady got back to me and said what she did is, so you would trim the excess, but still leave a bit, but like say trim all the corners. Then you'd sew in around, but don't pull it, but pull it a little bit taut. So you'd have it all gathered and then do like web it, so there'd be the hole in the middle, so it's kind
okay.
of, it's secured, so you're webbing it through, so you're sewing across and across and across and across like this. And then she gets like a separate piece of fabric entirely, not even, I mean, you could do the same as this, but she had a nice pattern one that then she just presses on
okay.
top, so you're hiding the entire back of it.
Okay.
And it can be just a nice clean little piece then that can be hung up. But actually then she said you can also take that out of the hoop. But I don't know, then would it just fall apart? I don't know. I didn't. Take the hoop out then and you'd have just this circle.
Oh, okay, alright. Oh, okay, so because
maybe
it's been gathered up so much and
yeah,
so
it would hold a shape.
Yeah, so it's kind of gathered in a bit like a yo-yo. Do you know what a...
Yes, yeah.
So a bit like a yo-yo.
Uh-huh.
And then, so then you've got like, I don't know, a piece of felt or a piece of material,
yes,
like you said,
yeah,
that mm-hmm. you're attaching to this.
Yeah.
And it's kept it circular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then she said you can then use that circular, maybe if you wanted, I don't know, I suppose you could sew it onto like a cushion cover or something or whatever. But anyway, or I would probably leave mine in the hoop to be fair, but
because it just gives it away a place to be hung as well,
yeah,
doesn't it? Yeah.
So yeah, anyway, here we go.
I think it's lovely.
Very first beginner embroidery project. I'm chuffed with it.
It's really cool.
I know my mum will like it.
Is this just like a satin stitch?
That's a satin stitch, and then I just did backstitch then running all up here.
Very cool.
Yeah.
A denim.
We were saying when
she came in earlier, it's like a denim material. See, we've already had a chat about this.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh my god, it's so nice. What is it? La 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 la.
Yeah.
So it's like a denim.
Yeah, and it's a light denim I had bought, as I was telling Laura earlier, to make a skirt like about a million years ago. And I wanted something dark because I wanted the bright colours to pop. And I just thought it'd be a bit modern.
Do you know what colour you'll do the mum in?
Yeah, I would say I want to do it a different colour, but I was thinking maybe like something like this, but maybe not that exact colour. But I wanted it to stand out because I don't know if the green probably doesn't stay. It stands out a bit better,
yeah.
It probably doesn't show up as well here. But I wanted maybe it in a lighter colour to stand out a bit more.
It's really nice.
Yeah.
I think she can be chuffed.
I think she will be chuffed.
And she doesn't watch the podcast.
Oh, she does?
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. But she's on holidays at the moment,
okay.
So by the time she watches it, I'll have given it to her, so it'll be fine. Yeah. Yeah, she does watch.
So we should have given a warning before. Don't watch.
Yeah. Okay, Josh. Spoil the surprise. But actually, she's on Instagram as well, so she's already seen the photograph.
Okay,
I reckon. Although, as I said, she's on holidays, so she might not be on social media at all. But yeah, it's funny. Yeah, she watches the podcast, and all she says is, oh, you looked lovely. I'm like, thanks, Mum. And my dad is so funny. I swear, you look like a TV presenter. I was like, thanks, Dad. It's nice. Proud parents. That's funny.
That's good.
Yeah,
that's
kind of cute.
Whereas my daughter watched the last one and went, at the beginning, I thought it was really funny. You two were talking about your boobs, weren't you? When we put the music over, and I was like, yeah, we were. So my ta-da, I have, to be fair, I was going to swear then. That was going to be the first time I was going to swear. I've been a little bit, I've had an awful lot of free time. I'm a bit trapped. because my hubby's away, my eldest kids don't live here, and my youngest son Kai is really easy to look after. Sounds awful. And don't get me wrong, I could clean my house from top to bottom, and definitely sitting here with the light blasting in the windows this morning, I was like, yeah, I probably need to clean the windows. So I have been like crafting like nobody's business at the moment. And that's just avoiding all the other things I've got to do, like cleaning and paperwork and So if you remember that I showed you the spinning that I did.
Oh yeah.
It told me it wanted to be a hat.
Ooh, the colours.
I am so chuffed. Gosh. I love this. I don't know if it's gonna show up. This kind of red here.
Oh, yeah.
So where the pink's gone to the orange. I really love this colour.
Nice.
Really, really love it.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It's really nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
So now this has put me in a bit of a dilemma. This is just a pattern that I knitted up. I knitted up, did a couple of swatches. I put it on my blog actually. I did a couple of swatches and just tested what gauge I liked to add, what tension I liked to add.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think I decided that I liked it on a 4.5 millimeter or a 5.5, I can't remember. So I just knitted up a basic kind of slouchy hat, which I don't know if I'll keep or if I'll send it to a certain person in Brighton.
Oh, it's so nice.
So, and I did it to the way that she likes it. Maybe I will send it to a certain person in Britain. And I have this much of it left. But it's now put me in a bit of a dilemma because I really aspire to be able to spin really fine, really beautiful, really like a constant gauge and everything, do you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then ply it up beautifully. But at the same time, I can buy yarn like that.
Yeah.
And
I think this is lovely.
I really like something about the uneven texture. There's and that's not because I'm being a cop out.
Oh no, there is though. There's a character to it.
Yeah. Like I would really like a jumper. That kind of texture. Mm. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I have a real dilemma because I'm like, I really want to be able to spin beautifully and lovely and smooth and fine yarn and make socks out of my spinning, my spun yarn. But yeah, the character, as you say, so I'm really quite chuffed with that.
Because we did a spinning workshop, a drop spindle workshop for the last issue, and the lady, Liz, she was super nice, but she had said that once you start getting better and better, you then lose that kind of unevenness and character. And sometimes some spinners be like, I actually wouldn't mind being bad at spinning again, or kind of like a beginner spinner. Because when you get perfect, it's just like, as you say, like something you would just buy.
Yeah.
Whereas when you have that kind of unevenness.
Like I've just finished it, but it's too wet. I've just washed it recently. I've just done a Blue Face Leicester braid that I had. And I'm trying to teach myself to spin across the top. I have a braided show you, but I don't have. So when you're spinning, some people separate their fibre down, when they separate their tops down. And I don't want to do that. I'm trying to teach myself to spin across the top, which is quite difficult because your hands are already doing bits and pieces, different things, your feet are doing different things, and then you've got to try and incorporate a different thing. And basically what you've got to do is try and pinch where you're drawing from and then keep pinching along. And normally this hand doesn't do very much on a, I'm doing it on a short forward draw. So I'm trying really hard to teach myself that, and that's so frustrating and so slow. My yarn, like I go through bits where my yarn is lovely and then it's like, nope, there's another great big lump gone through. And I'm like, just leave it, it's fine, we'll just get the practice in. I'm torn.
Yeah.
And I've chain plied that, which I'm like, maybe I should just stick with learning one thing.
Yeah.
So I hadn't chain plied before, maybe I should just keep doing this spinning off the top.
Oh,
and
what's
just
chain ply?
So chain ply is effectively like a crochet, so this is just a two ply.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
So I had one of my bobbins with spun yarn on and another bobbin with both the singles on, and I just chain plied off of the two different spindles. Yes. bobbins, sorry.
Oh, yeah,
uh-huh. But this other one, what you do is you can do it on a continuous, so you only have one bobbin.
Okay.
Don't you have more? You spun more than one bobbin usually, but, and you just work on that, and you're basically chaining the yarn on itself, making it into a three.
Oh, right.
Three.
Oh.
So a bit like crochet.
Okay.
So it's like a continuous chain.
Okay.
I'll show that next time if I haven't started knitting it. I might actually knit it. It was a blue and white BFL called Cumulus, is that how you say that? The clouds?
Oh, the yeah. clouds, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it really, really lovely. And there was a slight purple tinge to it, which I mentioned on my Instagram post.
Oh, I saw that.
Yeah.
It's
and
nice,
actually,
though.
Yeah, there's definitely a purple tinge to it knitted up. I'm thinking it might become a cowl, is what's kind of talking to me. My yarn talks to me quite a lot. There's no one else around here to talk to me. That's the problem. There's cows, there's dogs, and then there's my son who games all the time. So that's my ta-da. And yeah, I have quite a bit left.
Yeah.
And that red as well.
Oh my goodness.
So, yeah. And then a second ta-da that I had.
That's so nice.
Was this, which I actually only finished last night. I haven't finished it. It needs to be washed, and I need to work out what I'm going to do with the ends. So.
Wow.
Ooh, it's quite long, isn't it?
Oh, it's cool.
So that's...
Wow. I love it.
Yeah. I really like... I don't like... I put up on Instagram, didn't I, that I don't like fancy yarn.
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
not really a fan of fancy yarn. But in weaving, they just look
yeah.
really good. I mean,
like
this...
That, yeah.
I think this was a Crystal Palace yarn. I wouldn't knit with that.
Yeah, no, you wouldn't.
No, but I love the texture in
yeah.
it. This is an eyelash yarn. One of the
yeah.
the old-fashioned eyelash yarns. Old-fashioned. They were around a few years ago. They're probably back in a few years. But that, I love that in that.
I love these parts.
Yeah, that's fibre. And again here, so there's green fibre there. And then I think I put white or cream. So, oh yeah, there.
Yeah, nice.
So this was done with just yarn. Just
right.
from my stash. Just bits and pieces of yarn from my stash. And my thinking with this, I've actually had this... walked up on my loom since we did the dye-in last year. I haven't got round to it. My thinking with this was I was going to make two or three panels and just sew them together and then use them at the top of my landing as like a makeshift blind, you know, where maybe I sew a bit of doweling in and then you just roll it up from the bottom because it's quite insulating.
Yeah,
and
it's
that
lovely, yeah.
window at the top of my stairs just Force Nightingale comes through that.
Oh, okay. Oh, that'd be cool.
That's what I was kind of thinking.
Yeah.
Pretty much every wall in my house is taken up with something. I don't think I have the space for another wall hanging.
But you wouldn't be. Would you recreate this exactly? Would your three panels be slightly different?
I think they'll all be slightly different.
Yeah.
Probably all similar colours.
Mm-hmm.
But and I think it will take three. I was trying to work it out.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think that's my thinking at the moment. And I don't. I like this because this was done with wool and my warp was done with wool. So it had stretched because I'd left it for quite a long time. So when you look at it, I think predominantly more towards that end, I'd say. Yeah, so look, where the warp had got completely stretched, I'd gone over.
Oh.
Instead of going through the same equally under and over, I'd gone.
Oh, okay.
But I'd messed up, but I actually don't mind it. I like...
Oh, yeah, no,
yeah,
it's nice.
Here was quite bad as well. So, yeah. But it was all super chunkies and then just kind of mixed in with...
Mm-hmm. Well, there's some... It's like,
Yeah, it's like a furry, a longer eyelash yarn. Like one of those fake furs.
Yeah, yeah.
It was very thin.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it was really thin. And this one's got ribbon in it. This one has like a ribbon going through.
Oh, I like that, yeah. It's nice that's over here as well.
Yeah. I just love them in weaving. They just add really nice texture.
Texture is good.
Yeah. I said that I could end up making just another one and end up using it on the table or something because I do like having the weaving on the table, and I haven't finished my ends. And I'm actually not sure I will.
Yeah, well,
if it's going up against my window, no one's going to see it. So
God, yeah, that'd be a nightmare.
Yeah.
If sewn all those in.
I'll give it a wash and it'll bloom. It'll bloom a little bit better and it'll fill the gaps. So
okay.
Yeah. No, I really.
Would
like
you
it.
Wash that in like the? You clan as well, or
to be fair, I might actually just shove this in a big pillowcase and bunk it in the washing machine on a cool wash because I would like to see what happens. But I'll tie it tightly in a pillowcase just to.
Cool, I love it.
Yeah, Yeah, so my son, he was okay last night. I said to him, I'm coming in to do some weaving. I had it set up in the office. And he was like, oh, okay. So I put my headphones on just in case he wanted a little bit of privacy. He kept chatting away to me. I was like, oh, yeah.
You talk when I don't want to talk.
Yeah, yeah. That's it. It's always the same way. What are you watching? No.
Hang on now. I've been trying to talk to you all day. Yeah, I can imagine.
So, yeah, I would definitely... That's what I do with my loom. I tend to use my stash up.
That's really handy.
Try to use my stash.
I know. Well, look, my stash should never be used up. It's impossible.
So I just thought it was something a bit different.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, it's lovely. It's really cool. As you can tell, I've obviously not been very productive. So I'm still knitting those pixel stitch socks. But I have progressed to I've turned the heel So I made an executive decision when I was down and knitting, not last week, obviously the week before, it was just myself and Dr. Sock. And we were talking about, I was knitting my, because I think the last time we spoke, I literally just got to
here.
Yeah,
you have,
So you'll see that the pixel stitch itself is kind of really, it's really pretty.
It is really lovely.
I love it. And then I then made, because I was going to do everything, the persimmon colour, orange, but then I was talking to her and I was saying, oh, I wonder should I do the second pair, the stone colour, and then we were thinking, well, what if we do like the stone and then the orange cuff, and then on the other pair do stone toe, orange heel, stone cuff.
Oh, okay.
So that's,
yeah,
I think what I'm gonna do.
Yeah,
so you'll see that I have so bear in mind these are my first toe up socks. So I was a bit apprehensive about like doing the gusset, mm-hmm, and the heel, turning the heel and then the heel flap, but actually it's really,
really
well
good.
And I had to do short row shaping to shape this, and I hadn't done that before either, so I was like, oh god, but actually it really worked out well, and the gusset is seamless, like
very good,
it's seamless, yeah. Like there's no holes. I mean, I'll probably have a little bit of a hole here just where I had to join back in again. but actually, I've kind of kept it nice and tight. But actually, it's turning out really well.
I think they're gorgeous, and the way the color change in the yarn is,
yeah,
the slight from the,
this does, like you can see
the tones, yeah,
yeah, and it gets really light at certain points, and then goes nice, but nicely back to dark. So it has a lovely, yeah, just a nice kind of quality to it, the color. So I'm really happy with them. So now that I've, you know, I'm just working on the leg now, basically. I need to do 4.5 inches and then I just start doing the cuff, so I should fly up with that, to be honest, and hopefully I will have, rather than just sticking with a hoe, I will actually finish the second sock. But I think actually now that I've done it and I know what's what here, I'll fly through it, because I think I was about here last night and I did the whole thing in about, you know, 2 or 3 hours last night.
Good.
When I'm sitting down watching
TV. Are you
TV.
Enjoying it?
Loving it,
yeah.
The yarn is so beautiful. And I can kind of tell that I'm going to have quite a bit left
you
over.
Are.
Yeah. How much it cost?
We started again, did we? I think. No,
I was still going. Who can tell? Yeah, because what I think in the last podcast, not the last one, but the one before, where I was showing the little bit that I had done, and I was talking about, you know, how expensive it was or whatever, a lady commented and said, you know, you're going to have like lots left over, you're probably going to be able to make, you know, another pair of like maybe Rose City roller socks or whatever. And I was like, oh yeah. So actually, yeah, when you kind of work it out, even though it might have been a bit expensive, I'll probably get a bit more out of it than just a pair of socks. So
yeah,
so
you could always use the extra bits as well in a shawl, do you know, like you could have
more
like either a completely different colour, you know, like maybe a mint green or something like that,
cool.
Or a more neutral ivory or something, and then put them in as well.
Yeah,
yeah, they look really good.
Yeah, so
they are lovely.
Yeah, so I'm chuffed with them.
Yeah, really nice. So it'll be lovely when it's finished. I'm actually wearing a version of what I'm knitting because I thought that was the easiest way to do it. So this is the Mary. It's called the Mary Rebecca by Ellen
so
Mason. I'm not going to take the credit for this. I didn't knit this. One of my friends knitted it for me, actually. I have a good friend called Jill in the UK. And she's in her 70s. And her mum actually owned a yarn shop when she was young. So this woman is like a knitting genius. And she knitted this one for me, I think it was a few years ago now, and when I look at it, it probably does need a little bit of depilling at this stage. It's actually out of Cascade 220, which I bought to do something else, and then taste changed and I didn't like it. And I used to send Jill knitting regularly when I had the shop, because with knitting all of the samples for the shop, I very rarely had time to knit for myself.
Yeah, sure.
But obviously when you have a shop, you're the best advert, really.
Yes, yeah, that's true.
So I have tons of knitted jumpers. A lot of them have been knitted by Jill. So I thought I'm going to knit myself one. And actually, strangely enough, despite all the navy I have, I don't really have a navy cardigan.
Oh, no, that's true.
Yeah, I've got one, which is a summer navy cardigan, but not, and it's done in a cotton blend. So I don't actually wear it a lot.
Okay.
So I thought, I'll do myself this. So it's one of the ones that you do, you work the body in one, you work the sleeves, and then you join for the yoke, which I don't think you can see. You probably can on the back if I
see here.
Mm-hmm. So you join it all together, you get your body done, your two sleeves, and then you join and you work on your yoke. And this lace panel keeps running all the way up, so it's a bit like the fern lace from the Woodlawn vest.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it has a cable to the side of it. I'll see if I can show you that. I don't know if you'll see it on this because of it being maybe. No, it's not really showing up.
It's kind of need to pull it out.
Yeah.
A little bit.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
So it's actually a really, really nice
design. Yeah, it's lovely. I like it.
Yeah, really nice. And I'm using the Tivoli Celtic Aran, which I haven't lied about the fact that I love this yarn.
Yeah.
And it's in the shade 954. So I've done the body up to the bit where I need to do it, and they're shaping, so it shapes in for the waist and comes back out.
Yeah, it's really, it's kind of a nice feminine cardigan.
Yeah,
isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it looks really nice over the tunics that I wear. I tend to wear a lot of tunics, and then I've got one sleeve done. So I need to do, and it's a, as you can see, it's just comes to the elbow.
Mm-hmm.
On the design, actually, Ellen has included like a, I suppose like a wrist warmer. And it's and it has the lace on it, which I do have for the pink cardigan. I should have brought them down. Jill very kindly knitted me those at the time as well. I don't think I'd even noticed that they came with it. And when she sent the cardigan over from the UK, I'm like, oh, what are these? So I've done the sleeves. And the only thing I've changed is on the original design, it has garter stitch. It has four rows of garter stitch for the cuff. But I've done four rows of rib, just because I wanted it to tie in a little bit better.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But yeah, it's not, I'd say I'll get the other sleeve cast on today. I was going to do it yesterday and then went off and did the weaving instead. So I'll get the other sleeve cast off today. And I'd really like to think I'll have that done by the next time we podcast.
Wow, that'd be cool.
So I only cast it on, I think, a couple of days after we podcast. See, so yeah.
Wow.
Crafting mad.
Yeah.
Yeah, I need to do something. Unfortunately, Kai, we live a couple of miles away from the school, and the school bus is full, so I'm kind of trapped by
his times.
Yeah, because I've been looking, would I go and do some part-time work or something like that? So I might just have to, I don't know, maybe I'll have to do something from home. something else from home.
Yeah.
Just to keep me. Mind you, it's going to be nice and I can start gardening.
Well, there you go.
Maybe.
I don't know how long this weather is going to last, but it's certainly beautiful. I can't stop looking out the window. I'm just like, ooh, nice.
Yeah, no, it is lovely. Lovely. Yeah. I don't know if we will end up putting it on, but if we have, then you've seen it. I took a video this morning when I walked the dogs and I kind of stood at the top of the farm and just did a 360 of all of the, I think it's the Galties, I might be wrong.
I should know
where I live.
Is it the Cumras? I don't know.
I think the Cumras are further down.
Oh, okay.
I think it's the Galties.
Oh yeah.
Terrible. I'll find that out, I'll put it here. Yeah. But I kind of stood and took a 360 degree of the hills all around me.
Yeah, it's really lovely out here.
Yeah, very nice. I don't know if they were dog bombed or anything like that because I couldn't see where the dogs were. The sun was shining too brightly.
So, yeah, it'd be nice to see your house as well, though. Covered in, like, all kinds. Yeah. life.
There's a tractor out, muck spreading. It's not spreading today, but it's parked in the field, so the tractor was in the field, so that's definitely in the pictures as well. It's not smelt very nice around here for the last few days.
And that's the disadvantage of the farm living, isn't it? Like, yeah.
And flies. Flies are horrendous. Mm. Flies are a real problem.
Oh, gosh. But aside from that,
it's beautiful. It's lovely.
You can ignore all of those things.
Okay, back to the magazine. Oh,
so you have your fibre, actually, your aforementioned fibre.
Oh, no,
fibre.
Do yours.
Oh, well,
yeah, because I haven't seen yours, and I always see yours.
So mine isn't, it isn't yarny, but I actually realised that a lot of people who are into crafting and knitting and all of the stuff that we're into are also into, like, pretty stuff, like stationery. Now, I am a stationery nut, like, ridiculous. Like, because when Laura first, I think we were in knitting group, and you happened to mention that you'd got the, like, a beauty box with, like, little sample bits and pieces.
Yeah.
A subscription box. And I was like, oh, yeah, subscription box. And you were like, did you know you can get stationery subscription boxes? No. So,
just hyperventilating.
I was like, like, had stalks, and I was like, I don't. Straight on the phone and literally signed up for a stationery box at knitting, pretty much. And so I've signed up to receive every month this stationery box from a lady in the UK called, well, the company is called Honey Tree. And every box has a theme, and you get it comes delivered nicely, all wrapped up and everything. So this is February's theme, and rather than doing the obvious love theme, she actually went for like a vintage team nostalgia. So you get like loads of bits and pieces in it, so I'll go through. So you get some cards, so
I like that.
There's a lot of I think she has like a lot of typewriters, like vintage typewriters illustrations in this.
Okay.
So you get like these blank cards. I mean, they could be used for anything. Oh, actually, that's a birthday one. You're not old, you're vintage. Happy birthday. I have that earmarked for a friend, actually. And then there's another one here, actually. Just a blank one. You're just my type.
Oh,
it's
very
really nice,
cool.
Right?
Yeah.
This typewriter is really cool.
Yeah.
And then I got a selection of just like thank you cards.
Oh,
they're accompanying envelopes, so they're really handy.
Oh, they're really nice.
Yeah.
And they're good quality.
The card is good quality. Yeah, exactly.
I really like those.
Yeah. Because it's just nice to have those little bits and pieces and a bit of something a bit different.
How many is it? There's four.
There's four cards there, and then. She did. Then she sends these, just a plain card, but you could frame this.
Yeah.
Or, you know, I suppose you could actually send this as well, right on the back of it. But I just love the...
That's really
I
nice
love
illustration.
Vintage typewriters.
Yeah,
they're so
really
pretty.
Nice illustration.
And then just another, just a note. So
very
it's
cool.
Like literally just pop it in an accompanying envelope. And then these little, tags, which are kind of nice to hang off.
Oh, they'd be cool for knitting.
They would actually, wouldn't
they? Yeah.
And they have the little hole here. And then she included the baker's twine with that as well. So you could kind of use that in conjunction with those. So every box is different. Like I had the previous box from January was a cactus theme. And so everything had little cacti on it. I don't know what the theme, like she announces the themes in advance of the box, but maybe a day or two in advance. So you don't really know what you're getting really, unless you're kind of paying attention on Instagram. So it's a nice surprise to see it coming through, and then you have no idea what's going to be in it as well. And it was just, I think I'm paying £15 per box.
And that's including delivery, is it, or is delivery more?
Delivery then is maybe another £3, I think, on top of it. So like £18. So it's about €20, I guess. Which
I think that's fair.
It's okay. I mean, the quality is good.
Birthday cards cost a bloody fortune now,
don't
they?
Well, that's true. Like you could buy a birthday card and it'd be a fiver.
Oh yeah, some of them are horrendous.
Yeah, and I mean, it's obviously not. It's good quality.
Yeah.
It's original, like as in.
And it makes you think a little bit more about,
that's,
I suppose,
that's true.
I'm a big fan, and I know you are, of writing something or sending a card.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're all short of time. not me at the moment. But sending a text message, I don't know, it just doesn't,
no.
It's not the same, is it?
No.
Happy post. Everyone loves happy post.
It's so nice to get a letter or a card in the post.
Yeah.
It's really nice.
Yeah. No, I really like that. I think they're
really,
really lovely.
Yeah, I'm really happy with it, actually. And it just comes, you know, it comes... Like you
it's coming really nicely presented as well.
It's nicely kind of wrapped up in the little box, and she has a little note on every issue, and you know, it just comes
very
in,
cool.
And I'm like, ooh, my stationery box. So yeah, I'm delighted with it. Like you could do, like if you signed up, I think what I might do is change my subscription, because I just signed up for like the month by month, because I signed up initially just to see if I would like it and think it was good value. But actually, if I signed up for 6 months, it would be cheaper again.
Okay.
Or, you know, if you commit to a year, and like, you know, with most of these boxes, that's the way it works. So I think I probably would commit to a longer kind of subscription period and then get it for cheaper overall, actually. So
I was looking at a Fibre subscription, a monthly Fibre subscription. And the Fibre looks lovely, but it's a UK company, and it's, I think the Fibre is only £10, which is... extremely reasonable. But the postage was going to be £7.50. And that's
yeah
I mean the postage is expensive and the costs are unavoidable, but £7.50 is
it's a bit much,
75% of the cost of what you're buying. It's, so it would be different if I was in a group with people and we got maybe 3 or 4 subscriptions all sent at once.
Okay,
do you know?
Exactly.
But it's prohibitive.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah, definitely. It always amazes me how expensive the shipping is between the UK and Ireland.
Oh, it's so frustrating.
Yeah,
it really is.
Sometimes it costs less to get something sent from Canada than it does to get it sent from the UK.
Yeah.
Or from up in Northern Ireland or whatever. Just ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. I love that. I think that is really good.
Oh, I'm really chuffed with it.
And it was so funny.
Oh my God. Honest to God, it was like... Everyone was like, you were all just going, she's serious right now? Because I was absolutely, what? I need to see this immediately. Stationery, box, subscription.
She'd gone, no knitting, the knitting had gone down the table.
Gone.
No cake eating, no tea drinking. Yeah. She was literally just like this with the phone.
Sorry, are you talking to me? No, I have no idea. Oh yeah. She like, whenever I go to like, you know, you guys be, you know, we go to different cities and go on holidays or whatever, and you'd be like, oh, did you go to the yarn shop? I'm like, yeah. But anyway, I went to this nice little stationery shop. It's amazing. Like, I just gravitate towards stationery. And I have like, I was doing a clear out. I was selling a few bits and pieces in the house recently, just trying to clear it out. And I had an old desk and I was clearing out the drawers. And I had all of these amazing like post-its that I had forgotten about, you know, with like cool little things written on them and like cute little illustrations. I was like, I was so happy. I was like, I thought I'd lost you. There you are. This one with like cute little pandas. Oh, I was so happy. Yeah. Anyway.
You'd love Brighton then. There's definitely, I definitely saw two.
Oh my God.
Yeah, you were there, weren't you?
I was there,
yeah.
And I did go into
paper
shops.
Chase as well.
Oh, stop the lights. They used to have paper chase in Cork upstairs in Aywer on Patrick Street.
They?
It was just like a little section.
Okay.
And then when they closed it, I was devastated. Like, yeah, absolutely. I was like, oh my God, what? It's like the best part of my life. If I went into town, I would just go straight up there and say to Glenn, see you later, I'm just going to have to paper chase. Oh my God, yeah, it's ridiculous.
Yeah. Well, plus the fact, I mean, it's a nice, usually it's quite a reasonably priced thing to pick up as well, isn't it?
Do you know, something pretty. Little bits and pieces.
No, I think it's a good thing. Like, the days of picking up a lipstick because it's a nice treat at the weekend to yourself, they're gone.
Oh my
God, like a lipstick is so expensive now. So my we had to have it is actually fibre, like I said. So this is you can see it's from Irish Fairy Tale Yarns. They have Irish Fairy Tale Yarns have a closed Facebook group, and on their Facebook group they have a normal Facebook page, and to get on the group you just have to ask.
No.
I suppose, yeah. I assume it's just to avoid any kind of spam. But they had a sale last week or the week before, I can't remember, And they were part of theirs. They had lots and lots of yarn, but they had fibre as well. So I just saw this. This is a blue face Leicester, 100% blue face Leicester. The colour number is 91. I'll open it so that you can see it.
The colours are cool. This that is, green is wicked,
yeah,
isn't it?
It's really cool, isn't it? So,
wow.
So, yeah, so there we go.
Lovely.
It's really lovely, isn't it?
Yeah.
This. So,
really nice.
There we go. Yeah. And I just really liked it. And because I like Blue Face Leicester so much, I just thought it would be really nice.
Yeah.
I think I will probably, I'll probably card this a little bit. It's a little bit, in the dyeing process, they can get a little bit kind of matted on themselves.
Yeah.
So I think I'll probably card this out, open it up and give it a bit of a card.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I might make it into Rolex, small Rolex.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Please, whatever. Sounds rude. Just me, obviously.
What is it?
Poonies.
Poonies?
Yeah.
Maybe I don't want to say what you're like. Yeah. Think, yeah, okay. I'm not going to fall into that trap. Should make me say it, then I'll say it. That'd be the worst in the world.
But it does, yeah.
Yeah, okay, fair
it's
enough.
It's kind of rude, so. I tried. So. Nope. Yeah, so I just think I might card it. It's just a little bit kind of the dyeing process. It's just kind of settled into itself. Look, when I pull it, it's drafting better. That end I'll probably pull off because that end has felted a little bit. But the rest of it is fine. It just needs kind of drafting out a little bit more. But yeah, cool. I think it's really nice.
Yeah.
It's a really lovely braid.
Yeah. Really nice. I love the different greens.
And I have hand carders, and they're just my hands. It's something my hands just don't like doing at all. It kind of hurts. I suffer for it quite a bit afterwards. So I keep looking at a drum carder. I might put it on a wish list. But I don't know if I get the use out of it so much, and they're kind of expensive.
So the hand carders are what Liz was showing us how to use, so like big cones.
Yeah, and a drum carder has, you have a big drum and then you have a smaller drum and usually a brush to help the fibre back down. And you can get electric ones or you can get hand cranked ones.
Okay.
But you're looking, kind of 200 and above.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Probably more like 300.
Okay.
Yeah. So I keep looking to see if I see one secondhand, and occasionally they come up, but more often than not, they're in the UK, they come up secondhand. There are definitely a lot of spinners here in Ireland, but I don't think they necessarily, a lot of people would spin here at home and maybe wouldn't think that there's someone else down the road who would spin.
Okay,
We've only got two guilds, haven't we? We've got the Cork spinning, weave spin guild, weave spin dye guild, and then we've got the Dublin one, haven't we? And even I'm in the Cork one, and though I know lots of people in the Dublin one, we don't.
Yeah, there's no crossover.
Be nice to kind of have a thing where we all get together.
And if you could even like have a repository where you could rent equipment.
The
like,
Dublin one
cool.
definitely has that.
Oh, okay.
And I think I could technically rent one, but I would have to go to Dublin to pick it up. And might be an idea. Yeah. I know a couple of ladies in the Cork Guild, I think, have one, so I might ask if I could borrow theirs. But you're always kind of nervous, aren't you, borrowing something that costs a lot of money? You're nervous borrowing anything, but you're nervous borrowing something that costs a lot of money because you're like, the responsibility. I offered someone one of my spinning wheels and they were like, no, suppose it breaks. I'm like, what's going to go wrong with it? Just, you know, I'm not using it, take it. So, but yeah, I can understand. That's my we had to have it.
Yeah.
So once that will be on my spinning wheel, once I'm spinning some, what am I spinning? Some Corridale, and I think it's Corridale I'm spinning at the moment.
Oh, cool.
So again, across the top. Oh yeah, so that's what I was trying to say about spinning across the top. So normally a lot of people would separate this braid out, so they pull it out, you can see the top, and they might separate it this so you can see there.
Okay.
Maybe they'd separate it like
this.
But what I'm trying to do is take the fibers and spin across, draft across the top here.
Right.
So, and this is my drafting hand. I draft with my left hand. So I'm trying to pull out from here.
Oh, gotcha.
And you move your thumb across here to help you pull it out.
Okay.
And yeah.
Seems like another
level. In my head, I'm like, yeah. pinch and draft. No, now move that hand. Like, why is it not coming out? So, yeah.
I look forward to seeing that now, yeah.
Yeah. So I think that's it, is it?
Yeah, that's us. Yeah.
All done.
So, we'll leave you with, go to the Ravelry group and sign up to the Cal.
Mm-hmm.
And if you haven't already checked out olannand.ie, then do, because we have loads of content there, like loads of really good stuff. And we have, we haven't spoken about this, but we have a new columnist as well who did patchwork. And she made a step-by-step tutorial on a scrappy patchwork quilt, which is really cool.
Mm.
So if you're interested in that at all, it'd be a nice one to look at. And then we have some crafty makes. My sister was raving about your mirror. She thought it was so cool. So so there's two nice crafty makes in there as well. And then there's our four designs, which are brilliant. I think they're really good. It's a really strong issue. So yeah.
Yeah. Jennifer's there as well, isn't she?
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah. Oh, she did some really cool investigation into creating a vegan friendly needle felting kit. And so she was testing all the fibers. So actually the results of her tests are there, and that's actually quite interesting reading if you're interested in how different fibers felt. How they felt. Yeah, exactly. And that's really interesting reading, actually.
I really like the new look. I'm really pleased with the new look. Oh, I'm
so happy with it. Yeah.
We still have a few things that we need to sort out.
Ah, yeah. Well, I think once we get those, once that clicks and those plugins, dirty plugins, work, then I think it'll be very straightforward. We just need to find that sweet spot where it actually works, and then
it looks much more. I don't know, it looks much more like a magazine, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And you can see how we've evolved, how it's progressed, and.
And it looks so much better on mobile and the tablets, because the other site just didn't respond well to different devices, so it just didn't look as good. So this new look really looks well on mobile, and I can see people are staying on the site a bit longer, because I look at the analytics, people are staying on the site a bit longer and moving around, so that's indication that, you know, actually they can move around.
Yeah.
And that's what people have said, it's easier to kind of navigate, which is good. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if you've any feedback, actually, we'd love to hear it.
Most definitely. Yeah. Yeah. We'll put the show notes in the Ravelry page, and we're actually going to, this week we're going to pop up a page on the magazine, aren't we?
Oh, yeah.
To keep the podcast, because we know that there are some people that aren't on Ravelry, so we just wanted to make sure that our podcast was kind of getting out there, and we were highlighting all the things that we wanted to highlight. So we'll see you in a few weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.